Alright, so Panther Prince got the opportunity to interview our mayor, Mayor Harry LaRosalier, correct?
Yes.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you, Alex.
Alright, so how much has Plano changed since you first took office?
Well, I think there's a number of things that's changed, but a lot has stayed the same. I think there's a lot more visibility about our city. We're in the national spotlight. That's been a goal of ours. But what's not changed is who we are. We're a city of excellence. We've always been a safe city, terrific schools, great infrastructure, and a great sense of community. That's not changed about our city. The other thing that's changed, I think, people have woken up and we're on the map, but we're on the radar now.
Yeah. So what accomplishments in your first term do you feel are your best?
I'm most proud of the economic prosperity we've brought. When I was elected, I made a bold statement that as mayor, there's not a company in the world that we would not compete for. And if it added value to our city, we would compete vigorously. Since being mayor, we've seen Toyota U.S. headquarters, FedEx Regional, Liberty Mutual, J.P. Morgan, just recently announced Boeing. Boeing opened up a headquarter of one of the new divisions, Fannie Mae, Hilti, a host of others. And I'm most proud of creating jobs for our community because that creates what I call upward spiral.
And then can you please elaborate more on upward spiral?
Well, upward spiral means that you have great jobs. The jobs that we're creating U.S. and regional headquarters, and they have what's called the multiplier effect. So, for example, Toyota bring 4,000 people to our community. There's going to be suppliers and people who do business with Toyota that's going to come naturally because they want to be close to a major corporation. Same thing happens with those others that I mentioned. So over the next 3 years, we're expecting about 30,000 jobs to come into our Legacy West Business Corridor. And the upward spiral means that people are working, they feed their families, they send their kids to school, they go on vacation, they create revenue for our city so we can deliver services.
Okay. So what do you feel like is one thing that you wish could have happened but never you were able to get past?
So really, I would say the only thing that hasn't happened yet that I look forward to in my second term will be two things. Number one, Collin Creek Mall, I think the revitalization of that is going to be key for the next phase of our city. Mm-hmm. And that's something we have.
Your opponents also, they cite that, more specifically Douglas Reeves, he says that there will be a fall in property values from all of this, all the development going on. So what is your take on that?
Well, it's interesting that he would say that when one of their biggest issues is that property values have increased so much and people pay more taxes.
Yeah.
So that's in direct opposition. Let me put it to you this way. Money Magazine rated Plano the third best city to live in America, the best in Texas. We're the safest city, and we do it with the lowest tax rate in the Metroplex. We have the lowest tax rate, we have the lowest debt per capita in any city around us. And so you go back and ask the person who said that any evidence that where our property values are declining, and I'll tell you, someone who is not in touch with reality, because the desire for people to want to be in Plano has never been greater.
So candidate Lily Bao has gained immense support around the city with her slogan, keep Plano suburban, basically.
Yeah.
What are the problems you think are associated with keeping Plano suburban?
Well, I don't even know what that means. I think I call that dog whistle politics. It's a term designed to attract a certain amount of people and say us versus them, and that's not what we're about. Plano's, the days of us being a suburb is long gone. My opponent came to Plano when I was mayor in 2014. So 3 years ago, she showed up. And she's going to tell us what we should go back to. I kind of find that humorous and borderline insulting, actually, because we're a city of our own. We have suburban character. We have beautiful neighborhoods. Two-thirds of our home, of our residents live in single-family home. About a third of them live in apartments and condos. And that's what makes us great. We have diversity on so many levels in Plano. We have diversity in housing. We have diversity in our people. We got diversity in our food that we offer, diversity in our businesses, and Plano is an incredible city, big city and a strong community. Our days of being a suburb is long gone, way before she even showed up.
So you're saying there's just no going back?
We haven't been a suburb for years.
Yeah.
We weren't a suburb before she showed up.
So East Plano, where I happen to live, I live deep in the heart of where all basically all this stuff is happening.
Yeah.
It has changed dramatically since I've been here, since like the early 2000s.
Change in what way? Let me ask you that question.
Well, honestly, in my immediate neighborhood, there's a lot of stuff is still the same.
Mm-hmm.
It still feels the same, but,
mm-hmm.
you know, I remember going to downtown Plano when the Queen of Hearts was still there, and I could go and buy my costumes and stuff for school plays.
Yeah.
And it used to be a...
Now it's a pizza shop.
Yeah, now
it's a
pizza shop.
Yeah, it's a lot.
So it's definitely changed a lot. And so for me, I've definitely, like, from my eyes, I've definitely been at ground zero. I've seen a lot of this stuff. So what else do you think is going to change in East Plano, but also West Plano, when you say Legacy West?
So here's what's going to happen in East Plano specifically. Mm-hmm. We're going to expand the footprint of our downtown. That's my vision for downtown Plano. Right now, our downtown is essentially 15th Street from K over to where the Courtyard Theater, the Haggard Park. We've expanded a little bit on 14th Street. But we have a number of developments that are occurring. Further down, we have the DART station coming on 12th Street. That's going to show up in about 2022.
Wow, so we're going to get another station.
On 12th Street, yeah.
Okay.
And that's due to come to Plano by 2022, I believe, early 20s.
Okay.
So that's going to expand our footprint. So just what you see happening in 15th Street with the DART rail, which has been kind of the heart of the revitalization, that's going to happen there. We have a 450-unit multifamily apartment building with a sky bridge that's going to be out where the Plano Marine is the location. So there's going to be more people, and so what's going to happen in between there and 15th Street, businesses will start cropping up. We're going to create more density. We're going to bring more people in, and we're going to go vertical, and then expand that footprint. So downtown will no longer be just 15th Street. It's going to go down to 12th Street. It's going to go over to 75, and then again, my vision is to see something major happen in Helen Creek Mall.
Yeah.
Again, we've had some terrific conversations with some folks, and it's just a matter of time before that happens.
Okay. So this isn't something I've seen all like across the board too, not just with candidates, but a lot of your supporters as
uh-huh.
well, and a lot of people that actually voted for you, my parents included.
Mm-hmm.
They both cite issues with, I guess, Plano government transparency.
Mm-hmm.
I've honestly haven't, you know, been looking much into what you guys have been doing, but from a lot of people that I guess try to follow what the government does every footstep, they feel like it's not transparent enough.
So I'll push back on that as well. If,
mm-hmm.
if you feel that Plano, since I've been married, is not transparent, then you're not paying attention. We have online transparency in our financials, so you can go and see every check we've written for whatever reason, expense. We created a dashboard that just came online late last year, early this year, where by the month, you could see how every single department is performing versus the metrics that we've created. So on a monthly basis, you could say whether we're in the green, I think yellow means neutral, and then red is mean below the app, where we survey our citizens on police, fire, planning, library, parks, property standard, all those, and it's all there on our website. So if you don't feel we're transparent, you're not looking for the information. We have town hall meetings. We have virtual town hall meetings. When I was at City Council, we used to have quarterly town hall meetings that have 60 people in the room. 30 of them were staff. The other 30 were people that show up at every single one. It's the same people.
Yeah.
We now have a virtual town hall meetings where you can go through social media, through Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, ask questions on the phone. And we had one just the other day, thousands and thousands of people participated that stayed on the line for the whole hour to be part of that. So if you don't feel Plano city government is transparent, then you're not looking for the information.
Okay. Here's a question that a lot of people have been asking. and or worrying about, or I guess wondering about too. But for a lot of the younger citizens out there, can you explain what the Equal Rights Ordinance is? Because they're not very...
So the Equal Rights Ordinance is a non-discrimination ordinance that we updated in this November of 2014. It was a 1989 ordinance that basically said, in the city of Plano, private businesses cannot discriminate against people of for race, gender, age. And it did not include sexual orientation and gender identity or military class. So we updated that in November of 2014.
You're saying everybody's...
All it is a value statement that says in the city of Plano, everyone matters. That's all it is. It was basically patterned off all the major corporations' corporate policies. We're the ninth largest city in Texas. Seven of the other eight cities in Texas had a similar ordinance. We by no means were groundbreaking. We were very late to the party on that one.
Okay, so opponent Bill Lyle, he views it pretty much as this, and he says, quote, "I cannot sit quietly while our elected city leaders erode our religious freedoms in the name of equal rights." So what are your thoughts on this statement? And just what do you think?
Religious freedom in America is the right to practice religion.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the right to discriminate against others. There is nowhere in our Constitution that prescribes discrimination is okay on the basis of your religious persuasion. And so, again, it's simply a value statement of who we are. Since we've had that Equal Rights Ordinance, we've not had one violation of it. It simply states that if you live in the city of Plano, everyone is equal.
So still staying on kind of that thought, Lieutenant Governor Dan Patrick, as you may know, he's trying to push forward the bathroom bill that a lot of people feel is just basically discriminatory rather than trying to protect people
mm-hmm.
that are
mm-hmm.
trying to use the bathroom. So what are your thoughts on the bill? Do you think a strict bathroom policy should ever be welcome in Plano?
So it's a solution looking for a problem. I think Governor Patrick should pay attention to the classroom versus the bathroom.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at the abysmal record that our Texas legislators have, how they've performed in terms of school financing
mm-hmm.
and their ability to not fund our school on a proper level, I just wish he would put his efforts there to educate you and your peers better and leave that alone. It's a solution looking for a problem.
About the recent, not recent, considering this is going to be the fifth time that's happened, but the texting and driving bill that they're trying to get passed, that they want to implement statewide.
Yep.
Why hasn't the city basically taken a, kind of adopted a ban? Because there's, I think, over 96 other cities in the state of Texas that have adopted a ban on texting.
There are certain issues that, as much of a no-brainer that it is, I think it's important when you're dealing with so many cities where people drive from one place to the other.
Mm-hmm.
A sense of uniformity is important, and I think when you have a patchwork of ordinances that have its own nuances,
yeah.
it can create a lot of confusion and unintended consequences, and so. Obviously, we're all against texting and driving, but there's certain things that should happen on either state level or national level, and so for that reason is why we've been cautious in moving forward with anything.
What are some of your plans? I know you mentioned earlier, but I just kind of like want to reiterate it and try to get into it more. What are your plans on trying to help lower income residents in Plano?
Well, the role of government is limited, certainly on a city and on the municipal level. In terms of what we can do. What we have done in the city of Plano and will continue to do is really work diligently with our nonprofit organization. We have Buffington Grants where we give $500,000 a year to nonprofit organizations
mm-hmm.
that help people who are in need for shelter, food, and what's the third one? I'm drawing a blank. Food, shelter, and third one, but I'm But basically, people in emergency and crisis is really what it's designed to do. We were the first city in Collin County to have that. We did $1 per citizen, which is at the time was about 250,000 people. We're at about 275 now. Since being elected, I changed it to either $2 per person or $500,000, but it's significantly more now. And it's never enough, but if you can support the nonprofits to create a safety net to keep people from being in a difficult situation.
Okay. So there has been obviously a very, a new influx of new Texans coming, mm-hmm. especially from California.
Mm-hmm.
Do you feel like, or let me try to reword this in a better way. So with like the new influx, like people coming in, how would you try to like make them feel at home being new Texans, basically?
Well, the way we make that happen is by being a welcoming and inviting community. I moved here 23 years ago from New York, and that can't be any more of a culture shock mm-hmm. than someone coming from California. But when I got here, I realized that, again, we're a welcoming, inviting city. We had an abundance of recreational, cultural, and educational opportunities to enjoy, and certain things we don't have in Plano, we have in Dallas, and some things we don't have here, we have in Frisco. And so we're part of a North Texas region that has incredible resources. And we are a global city in Plano. There's 90 native languages spoken in our schools. 64% of your peers mm-hmm. are non-Caucasian. And so we are a melting pot, and I think once people come here, they realize the myth of what they thought Texas was, you know, big hat, big belts, and big boots.
Yeah.
Is not the case. It's a lot of people from other places that make us a wonderful community.
It'd be nice to like elaborate more on the cost of living, because that is obviously what some people have been like worried
sure.
about with all the development going on. So
yes, so with all the with a lot of the companies coming, what we hear about often is the cost of living in Plano. Well, 19% of your tax bill, property tax bill, is what's attributed to the city of Plano.
Mm-hmm.
So we have the lowest tax rate in the Metroplex. If you were to, if you own a median home in Plano of $325,000, you pay $1,249 to the city of Plano. And for that, you get a police department that'll get to your house within 5 minutes of emergency. A fire department will get there within 6 minutes. 4,000 acres of parkland. We have Oak Point Park is about the size of Central Park in New York. This, no matter where you live in Plano, you're 15 minutes away from one of our 84 neighborhood parks. You have a world-class library system. It's an accredited library system. So we have all those for $1,225. The reason for that is because 50% of our property taxes are paid by businesses. They don't call the police at night. They don't get into domestic dispute. They don't fall down the stairs and call our EMS. They don't even use our trash services or environmental services. They don't use our libraries in the day. All they do is pay property taxes. And so the reason we enjoy that is because we attract businesses into our city. And we've done that by maintaining our infrastructure, providing quality city services. People want to come here. We have great schools. And that's why, that's again, that positive or upward cycle that we talked about.
Okay. And then, basically, do you just have any, I guess, closing remarks on for your bid for mayor, pretty much?
Yes, so early voting starts today, April 24th, ends May 2nd. May 6th is election day. It's my birthday, so if you're wondering what to give me for a birthday gift, I'll take her early gift. She's give it to between now and May 2nd. How about that for a shameless plug? But really, seriously, for my upcoming term, my vision for Plano is for us to remain the city we are. We're going to evolve. We're going to grow. We're not going to be the same. If you're staying the same, you're going backwards. we're not the, you know, we're not the city we were in 1980, we're not the city we were in 1990, and in 2030 we're not going to be the city we are today. But what we will be is we'll be a city that honors, that protects our people, keep our city safe, support our school district, provide quality services, and do that in the most cost-efficient manner by being the economic center of our community. And we're, that will not change. And so for the next 4 years of my term, I hope to, if I have the privilege to serve as mayor, my focus will just keep us who we are, but allow us to still grow and evolve.
And I just, these aren't really like questions, but it's just kind of like fun things I just wanted to ask anyway.
Yeah.
Okay, so do you have any like favorite pastimes?
Hobbies? Yeah, my hobby, I like to, you know, I enjoy working out and do that in the morning. That's kind of my quiet time. I work out and meditate in the morning. That's my only time of the day that I'm by myself. For fun, I like to watch reality shows with my daughters. Love and Hip Hop Atlanta and Love and Hip Hop New York are my two favorite ones. We like to watch it and goof on how unreal it is. And so that's it. Best time for me is spending time with my family. So I like to have one in college and one junior in high school. And yeah, that's about it. Serving on this level is the highest level of community service one can offer. Most people don't know, but this is a non-paying job. It's full-time, but it's non-paying. So I have two full-time jobs. I'm a financial advisor that pays the bills. This gives me what I call spiritual income. And so I've always wanted to give back to the community, and I've served on a number of nonprofit boards, but serving as mayor is easily the pinnacle of community service.
Okay, and then the big question that everybody just wants to know, are you going to run for Congress, or basically any kind of elected office after this, whether you have a second term or not?
You mean after my second term?
Yes.
After my second term. I'll put it to you this way. Any elected position other than being mayor of Plano is a demotion, and I haven't thought about taking a demotion. How's that?
All right,
is that for a politically correct answer? But this is a wrap.
All right. Well, thank you, Mr.
All right, man. Thank you. Appreciate your...